Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. It's a Friday Q&A episode where we track down an expert to answer listener questions. A brief note, the podcast receives some emails asking for individual health recommendations. We cannot diagnose or offer health advice to individuals. It's best to call your doctor or your local health department with specific questions. Now to the Q&A. Our respondent today is the remarkable Dr. Amesh Adalja, senior scholar at the Center for Health Security. He's a physician trained in internal medicine, emergency medicine, infectious disease, and critical care. Let's listen. Dr. Adalja, thank you so much for joining me to answer some of our listener questions. You ready to jump in?
Sure.
First question, what do we know at this point about reinfection?
So there have been a couple of well-documented reinfections, but the bottom line thing to remember about reinfections is that think about how many millions of infections we've had around the globe, and that there's only 4 reinfections that we're talking about. So this isn't the normal thing to expect. We know with most infectious diseases, once you get infected and you clear the infection, you have this period where you can't be reinfected. And I think that's the case for the majority of people who get COVID-19. There are these reinfections that occurred, and some of them, for example, one of the cases I think did not form an antibody. The others, I think if you would look, you'd probably find some immunologic reason for it occurring. So this doesn't change anything that we know about this virus. It doesn't derail the vaccine program. This is something that is really rare and not how the virus normally behaves. We think that there might be some ability to get reinfected after maybe a year or so, which is something we've seen with other coronaviruses. But these immediate reinfections over the first couple of months after are really aberrations and probably have more to do with the person getting reinfected than the virus itself.
Great, thank you. There has been a lot of concern over this inflammatory syndrome that can happen after coronavirus infection in children. What do we know about this syndrome in adults?
So this is something that they're seeing in adults, and it's an interesting physiological question because it's really distinct from the cytokine storm that people may have that we've heard a lot about. So this is something that also, again, probably has to do with the host genetics and the way the body interacts with that virus. It seems to be pretty rare. It's something that we're only hearing a little bit about right now. So I think that this is something that we know to be on the lookout for if we have people who have clinical symptoms that are compatible with it. But again, it's not a very common thing. And it's kind of an interesting phenomenon in how certain people react to the virus in certain ways. And that's, I think, common for many infectious diseases, that the immune system has a lot of idiosyncrasies that we don't know about, and different people have very different manifestations. So I don't think this, again, changes anything we have to think about or to do or tell the public, but it is something that doctors have to be aware of and think about recognizing when it occurs, not just in children, but also in adults.
Sounds like we'll probably learn more about this over time.
Yeah, I think this is going to take some time to unravel the whole story of MIS.
Great. Next question. There is the general guideline not to be within 6 feet for more than 15 minutes. Some people have interpreted that it's fine to be right up close with someone for 14 minutes. You have no chance of getting the virus. Is that a fair conclusion?
No, it's not a fair conclusion. You have to remember it's a continuum. 15 minutes is a number that is somewhat arbitrary. We picked it because you look at the way the epidemiology flows and who's getting infected by who. And so 15 minutes is kind of an easy round number for people to think about when you're trying to determine whether someone has a significant exposure versus somebody who doesn't. The main thing is that fleeting exposures, if you just walk by somebody, it's unlikely that you're going to get infected. But if you're with somebody for 14 minutes and 15 seconds, that's a significant exposure, irrespective if you didn't meet that 15-minute mark. So we use that as a ballpark. And while most exposures that result in transmission may cluster towards that 15-minute or more mark, there are going to be some that are occurring even before that 15-minute mark. So it has to do with the duration of exposure as well as the intensity. So if someone coughs directly on your face, that's a significant exposure, irrespective if it was only a 2-second interaction with somebody. So it's more of a rule of thumb. And it's helpful for epidemiologists trying to figure out where to direct their contact tracing, where to direct their public health interventions, because that's more likely to be where the transmission was when someone had more than 15 minutes. But it doesn't mean that you're completely ironclad if you were less than 15 minutes, especially if you're just kind of a hair under it, trying to watch your watch and run away when it hits 15 minutes. That's not going to protect you from the virus.
Got it. Great. That's super clear. If a person has completed 14 days in quarantine and has done fine, do they need a test before they can go back out?
No, they don't need a test before they go back out. We would release somebody from self-quarantine at 14 days after their significant exposure, irrespective of any test results. Some people may get tested anyway as part of a contact trace investigation, but that's not required.
So another question about quarantine. Let's say you're asked to quarantine because you've been exposed and you go out and get a test like is recommended and the test is negative. Do you have to keep quarantining?
You do have to keep quarantine. There's no way to test out a quarantine yet. You might hear about some sports teams doing it, but that's really not following the guidance because you have to remember that this virus has a 14-day incubation period and a test is only giving you an answer for one moment in time. So you could be negative today and still incubating the virus. And then 2 days later, your test would be positive. So that's why we recommend 14 days because of that incubation period and because a test is only giving you, it's not like a glucose sensor in your blood. It's only one moment in time. You have to remember that it's only telling you at that moment you don't have the virus.
Got it. Is there a COVID test that measures the viral load? And is there a correlation between the viral load and complication rate, kind of like you would see with HIV?
So PCR test, the polymerase chain reaction, the one that you hear a lot about, that one actually, the machines actually give you a viral load. It's just not reported to the patient. So we know where a person's viral load is when they test positive, and we can follow that over time. It's hard right now to basically map that onto symptoms and complications. We haven't done all of that work. I suspect there is some correlation, but not complete, because we know that children have high viral loads, but yet have very mild symptoms. So it's not ironclad. It's not something that has a one-to-one correlation the way it does with HIV. But it probably does have correlation with contagiousness, that people with higher viral loads are more likely to be contagious than some people with very low viral loads who may not be contagious at all. But it is something that we get on the machines. You can ask for what your viral load is. A doctor can ask and probably get the laboratory technician to tell them what the viral load is. But it's not something we're giving you don't get it on your little lab slip, but it is there.
Interesting. So we know what it is. We just don't know what it means.
Right. They report it as what's called a cycle threshold. It's how long it takes the machine to turn positive when it's doing the PCR. And that's what we use to, we can map that onto viral load.
Here's a question. If my school-age son is exposed at school and is sent home to quarantine for 14 days, can I still go to work?
So this is a tough question. And it has to do with, if you yourself were exposed, you technically don't necessarily have to self-quarantine. And I've asked some of my public health friends, maybe you have a different opinion, Josh, but they say they're not gone so far as to quarantine contacts of contacts because they think it's low yield and that it hasn't been something that they've recommended. And I know that we're definitely not recommending it for healthcare workers. I don't know if the companies may have their own policies for how they do this, but in general, I think most health departments are telling people they don't have to do that, but that may vary state to state, and you may have different information than I do.
That's interesting. I would say that what is absolutely clear is that if somebody is sick at home, nobody should be going into school or work,
right?
Because they should be considered contacts and quarantined until everybody is better.
Yeah, so if your child is a significant exposure but not sick, can you go to work? Most people are saying that's okay as long as you're monitoring that person. And if they get sick, then you put that person into self-isolation. But it gets a little bit thorny, and I don't think it's not an easy or obvious answer.
Right. You might want to talk it over with occupational health, for example. Herd immunity. What's your take on all this print and news coverage on herd immunity?
I think it's a kind of a distracting subject because what it's kind of doing is getting away from the actual business about getting this outbreak under control, which is testing, tracing, and isolating. Because if you do herd immunity, if you allow the virus to kind of run roughshod, you're going to get people hospitalized, you're going to get people killed by this virus, and you're going to have younger people who some of them are going to get hospitalized, some of them are going to get long-haul symptoms, and where they're going to transmit this to vulnerable people in the community. You might be able to protect your nursing homes somewhat. We didn't do a very good job of it early on, but you have to remember that there are many community-dwelling vulnerable populations. And I think that people have created this false dichotomy between economic shutdown on one hand and herd immunity on the other. And there's actually a proper way to do this, which is what countries like Taiwan did: test, trace, isolate, so that people can go about their activities of daily life, knowing that they're a little bit safer from the virus because people who are infected have been tested and traced and isolated. People are wearing face coverings. and you've modified businesses to be able to deal with living in a pandemic. Because I think if you go for a herd immunity strategy, what you'll end up doing is putting hospitals back into crisis, because that's de facto what's going on in places like Wisconsin right now, where hospitals are in crisis. So this is, I think, a dangerous way to think about this. If we get to herd immunity, it's going to be through the vaccine, not through natural infection.
I would just add that it's just hard to imagine that having your hospitals in crisis and everybody afraid of getting sick is good for the economy.
Yeah, the people will voluntarily social distance. Even if you look at countries like Sweden, where they quote they did a hybrid model, I guess is the way to say it, because you can Sweden is like the tea leaves. You can see whatever you want in Sweden. But what they did is that they
encourage people.
Had so much voluntary social distancing occurred. So people are still not going to come to your roller skating rink if there's a pandemic going on.
Right. Ivermectin to treat COVID-19?
So ivermectin is an anti-parasitic drug. You might have heard about it. We sometimes give it for people with scabies. There had been some in vitro reports from Australia about it working in cell culture. And then some individuals were using it in certain South American countries. There isn't any strong evidence that it works. Again, this is a little bit like the hydroxychloroquine study, that there was a lot of hype from cell culture, but not really much follow through when you put it into clinical trials. This is something I wouldn't necessarily recommend to anybody outside of a clinical trial, and not something that we've seen any strong evidence that it's beneficial. I think it's important to know these answers. There's lots of compounds that have antiviral activity against COVID-19, but the only way we're going to know is by doing this in proper clinical trials in humans rather than just looking at cell culture or giving it to people anecdotally.
Got it. That makes sense. Now, early on, there were some stories about COVID possibly being transmitted through poop. I'm using the pediatric term here as a pediatrician. Do you think the evidence for that has grown stronger or weaker over time? What is your level of concern about poop-related COVID transmission?
I think it's biologically possible, but it's not the main way people are getting infected. Even though you can find the virus and the virus is culturable from stool, there are individuals who have diarrhea as their presenting symptoms. I've had multiple patients like that. I haven't seen it really be the way that people are transmitting. And I do think we have pretty good sanitation in the United States. It might be something that we might see in certain populations where sanitation might not be that great. Again, the message still is hand washing after going to the bathroom. That's the way to prevent that. I haven't seen any strict epidemiological studies of it transmitting that way. There's been some interesting stuff with maybe a leaky pipe leaking on somebody in plumbing. There was a case, I think, in Hong Kong early on in the pandemic, but there hasn't really been much epidemiology to support this being a major route of transmission. It's person to person. Respiratory is the main way that I think people are getting infected.
Great. Just a couple more. Let's say a COVID-19 vaccine gets approved by the FDA and is about 50% effective, and someone takes that vaccine because its 50% effectiveness is a lot better than 0%, no vaccine. However, 6 months later, another vaccine gets approved that's 95% effective. Now, the question that someone wrote us was, can I take that second vaccine right away, or will I have to wait a certain amount of time after taking the first vaccine?
You may have to wait because there could be some interference between the two vaccines. And I think you need to do studies. And I would assume that there would be studies done if there was a better vaccine to see how they interact if someone has already been vaccinated with one of the prior vaccines. And it's not uncommon to have vaccines replaced. For example, our first shingles vaccine, Zostavax, has now been replaced by another one called Shingrix. And if you've been vaccinated with Zostavax, you can get a Shingrix shot. But you want to make sure that there's actually data to make sure you don't have an adverse reaction or that the one vaccine interferes with the other vaccine. So I would say stay tuned for that when it happens. And hopefully we do have a 95% effective vaccine eventually so that this actually becomes a real problem that we have to think about.
Right. I mean, part of the argument, though, is that you probably wouldn't want to wait around for a vaccine and have everybody waiting around and not taking the first vaccine, because the goal of vaccination is even a 50% vaccine widely used could be quite helpful. And then a second vaccine could really drive it down even further. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. So as soon as we have a vaccine that's approved and shown to be safe and effective, I think people should get it if they fit into the category to get it. And we shouldn't be waiting out for some magic vaccine that you think is going to come, because we don't know. If we have one in hand, I think that's the one that we'll use. And if something comes along, that will be great. But I think that we shouldn't delay any kind of vaccination program. People shouldn't delay their vaccine decisions waiting for the better version to come out. It's not like an iPhone.
Right. And there will be guidance on what to do if you've already been vaccinated, but it may be fine to take the second vaccine. We'll just have to see.
Yeah, they may be totally different technologies and not interfere with each other, not cause one to react strongly against the second vaccine.
Okay, last question. I'm going to read it directly. I was wondering about nose hair and how effective it is at stopping infections. I know several women who wax their nose hair and wonder if they should.
I don't think it's a major issue, but I mean, speaking physiologically or biologically, nose hair is there for a reason. It traps large particles and it is part of your immune system. So people, I would think if you look overall at people who wax their nose hair probably have less defenses in their nose. I don't think it's that big of a deal if you wax your nose hair. Just make sure you wash your hands and not when you do it, and do it in the proper fashion. So I don't think it makes a big difference, but yes, I do think probably it does interfere with your nasal defenses when you do that, because it probably causes inflammation and it causes cell damage when you rip the wax and the hair out, that there's often bleeding. All of that gives you a risk for infection. I think it's probably hard to quantify, but I'm sure it's non-zero, but not something I would worry too much about.
Got it. Great. Well, you heard it here first. I really appreciate your answer to that one, as well as to all our questions. Thank you very much, and good luck with everything you're working on.
Thank you.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmond, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.